I would give the word, first of all, to Yehuda Elkana, professor and rector of the Central European University at Budapest, distinguished historian of science, and for many years permanent fellow at the Wissenschaftskolleg in Berlin. Please, Yehuda.
Thank you. Being the first of the barbarians, I mean, the barbarian panel, I would like to dedicate a few minutes mainly to the future. And dealing with the future out of the diagnosis of the present, it obliquely deals also with Shmuel's question about the illiberal, intolerant, real dangers of the present. I think since we all know what the real problems of the present world are, I don't want to get into that. But I'm enough of an enlightenment fruit, as Nina said, not a Swedish fruit, but another fruit, enough of an enlightenment fruit to believe in ideas. And I think we are at a point, in order to be able to deal, to grapple intellectually, conceptually, with the problems of our age, with the intolerance, with the illiberal things, with the poverty, with the environmental crisis, with the spreading of infectious diseases, with the tottering political regimes, with the unexplainable or certainly not easily to be dealt with spread of religion, etc., I think we need a fundamental rethinking, not unthinking, the Enlightenment. And since, not because I'm a historian of science, but because science is a fundamental, enormously important element of our life, and it was not much mentioned today, I would like to remind us that the Enlightenment, and I don't talk about the big Enlightenment figures who were complex, sophisticated, interesting, they were all of them, the great figures were such that for every statement you can find the opposite in their works. So they were fine. But what we receive from the Enlightenment is a cluster of values which we now on the verge of having to get rid of. That's what I call rethinking the Enlightenment. And Shmuel's work, I don't know whether he will accept it as something related with his work or a bastard child of his, but for me it was enormously important in this sense, and I'll tell you the following. The cluster of values which was received by the enormously successful natural sciences and the social sciences, which emerged mainly aping the natural sciences, which influenced political thinking too, was a cluster of the following kind. It's rational, it's objective, it's non-dialectical, it's non-comparative, it's context-independent, it's certainly, if not opposing, discouraging heterodoxies, it is universalistic, it is strongly influenced the emergence methodological individualism, which I think is one of the poisons of the development in the social sciences. It has an abhorrence of contradictions, an abhorrence of uncertainties, and is basically thinking in linear terms. This is the kind of development which in the last periodization is always difficult, you may say 50 or 100 years, has begun to prove itself non-productive and doesn't give us the intellectual tools to deal with the problems of our age. Therefore, we need, and we needed very strongly, an intellectual attitude which liberates us from us. It is in this role of befreier, of liberator, that I see the oeuvre of Shmuel in a very, very interesting tradition. You can start with Vico, who was a very interesting figure, because Vico was trying to open up, to break up the limits of the Enlightenment, why the Enlightenment was itself being framed. So in this case, it was very unique. But in the 20th century, it is in the same sense that Cassirer was a liberator, in the same sense that Einstein was a liberator, a befreier of these limits. And exactly in these areas, one work after the other, Shmuel is a legitimizer and a liberator from these constraints. It is dialectical. It is, if not embracing contradictions, it's certainly not discouraging contradictions. It's very context dependent. It's certainly emphasizing heterodoxies. And it is a very healthy antidote to methodological individualism, which, after initial successes, has done an enormous damage to, I think, in the social sciences and discussing world problems. It came out of aping the natural sciences, but the development of the natural sciences are indeed such. In the last 20 years, I would say, again, these periodizations are never very healthy. But the last 20 years is opening up, indeed, to many contradictions, not liking them, but having to cope with them, It's encouraging heterodoxies in the sciences, which was unheard of before. It is certainly facing great uncertainties. And the most important element for me is that in most developments, we have to rethink methodologically how we deal with nonlinear problems, which is not in the making of the last 300 years as it developed. And in this development, in this approach, I think we may not, but we may begin to develop tools, and I'll give you just a few examples, to begin to think how, at least intellectually, to cope with the problems of the world. To remind you, we don't have a political theory of any developed value which tells us, beyond the Enlightenment encouragements, be rational enough or religion will disappear. We don't have the tools with dealing the role of the legitimate role of non-fundamentalist, moderate religion in the place of fabric of society. We don't have ideas how to deal politically with the fact that most of the world thinks in terms of dignity and humiliation as political concepts, not as a kind of be nice. We don't know how to develop, and we discourage developing, a kind of economic theory which, beyond the mathematics and the modelizing, which is indispensable and important, would be able to integrate into it concepts like aspirations, norms, values, in order to develop an economic theory which would begin to cope with problems of poverty. We don't even have the foggiest how to try to integrate sociological, anthropological, and other concepts into biomedical theories, so we could intelligently deal with the spreading of infectious diseases. Just remember one thing. The biggest and the richest foundation today, the Gates Foundation, is spending billions and billions and billions of dollars into aid research exclusively on the biomolecular level. There is very little consideration in the Gates Foundation of those sociological, anthropological, historical factors which we must take into account if we want really try to cope with these problems. The issues are endless. What I'm simply saying, we have to rethink in these terms the Enlightenment and the kind of work and the kind of encouragement which we get for intellectual liberators, like the work of Shmuel Eisenstadt, is beginning to be a guideline for the kind of bringing together the natural sciences, social sciences, and humanities, which is still absent, but is emerging, and is absolutely inescapable to bring them into account for a reform of the universities, which are vital for our civilization, and to rethink a new liberal arts curriculum, which presupposes a kind of literacy in economic problems, religious problems, environmental problems, legal problems, etc., without which we are not going to educate a generation which might cope with our problems. Thank you.